Now, the sons of Eli were corrupt. They did not know the Lord. What does that mean? They did not know the Lord. There was no fear of God before their eyes. They did not know the Lord. They did not reverence him. Verse 13, and the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered a sacrifice, the priest's servant would come with a three-pronged flesh hook in his hand while the meat was boiling. Then he would thrust it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and the priest would take for himself all that the flesh hook brought up. So they did in Shiloh to all the Israelites who came there. Also, before they burned the fat, the priest's servant would come and say to the man who sacrificed, give meat for roasting to the priest, for he will not take boiled meat from you, but raw. And if the man said to him, they really should burn the fat first, then they may take as much as your heart desires, he would then answer him, no, but you must give it now, and if you will not, I will take it by force. Why was the fat important? Why was this so important? Because the Bible says in Leviticus and Deuteronomy, the fat is the Lord's. So it was the Lord's portion. Okay? And they said, we'll take it by force. Therefore, the sin of the young men was very great before the Lord. For men abhorred the offering of the Lord. When there is mixture in the priesthood, the response of that in the people of God is that they begin to despise the offering of the Lord. They begin to despise the altar of the Lord. And they become disconnected from the place of the altar. Friends, your life as a believer, all of your spiritual substance as a believer proceeds from an altar. I know that you're aware of that because of the house that you're in. But we're saying it to encourage one another. It proceeds from an altar. Your life will only be as strong. Your ministry will only be as strong as your prayer altar is in private. You cannot have a public ministry of signs, wonders, miracles, prophecy that is legitimate. You can have a fake one, a false one. You can have a healing ministry where demons of infirmity jump from one person to another when you lay hands on somebody and you call it a healing. You can have a prophetic ministry where you're prophesying from third eye or from a python spirit and you call it the prophetic ministry. I've seen all of it as I've traveled. So don't mistake that there are manifestations of ministry that are very real, that look very real. People come up and, you know, testify, my shoulder was healed, my knee was healed, my back was healed, whatever. And just all that happened was a demon of infirmity. You know that it's a demon of infirmity when you lay hands on somebody and they say, oh, the pain moved. It moved. It was in my knee, now it's in my back. You know that that's, you're dealing with a spirit of infirmity. And there are many, many, unfortunately, ministries around the world that work in that type of exchange. It's actually an occult spirit. So you can have a ministry like that, but if you're going to have a legitimate ministry from the Lord, you have to have a prayer altar. And it will only be as strong publicly as your prayer altar is privately, okay? And so they began to abhor the offering of the Lord. So the people were disconnected from the offering of the Lord and the altar of the Lord because of the sin of these sons. That's verse 18, but Samuel, and how many are so grateful for Samuel? See, in this season, God is restoring his priesthood. God is raising up Samuels. God is raising up those not in the line of Levi, but in the line of Melchizedek. God is raising up the priesthood again in our day and in our time. But Samuel, say Samuel. See, we have a Samuel generation that the Lord is bringing forth on the earth. Samuel ministered before the Lord, even as a child, wearing a linen ephod. There is always a seed of hope in the midst of any devastating circumstance. Now turn over to Leviticus 10 and verse 1, okay? And let's look at just one more example of this strange fire as we're talking about the restoration of altars, the removing of mixture and everything. The Holy Spirit has been speaking to us all day in the worship, in the prophecy, everything. Leviticus chapter 10, verse 1. Then Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, each took his censer and put fire in it, put incense on it, and offered profane fire before the Lord, which he had not commanded. Another version would say strange fire. What does that even mean? Strange or profane fire? The fire was unknown to the altar. That's essentially what that means from a Hebrew perspective. So what does that translate into? Who lit the fire on the altar? Why was the fire on the altar? Leviticus chapter 6 even. The fire must be kept burning on the altar. It must never go out. That song that we sang just a moment ago. Why was the fire so important? Why was the priority of an entire nation of people to be to keep the fire burning on the altar? Doesn't that seem strange? Wouldn't there be other priorities for a nation? Wouldn't war be a priority? Wouldn't wealth be a priority? Wouldn't advancement be a priority? All those things. No, the priority for the people of God was that the fire would keep burning on the altar. And the reason that is because if you read carefully the text, you will see that the Lord himself lit the altar. The Lord himself, fire went out from the presence of the Lord and literally kindled the altar. So the altar was burning with pure and holy fire. It was fire that was undefiled. It was fire that was untouched by men. It was fire that wasn't mixed and wasn't mingled with something else. It wasn't profane or strange fire. But theologians, they theorize that what this meant, this strange fire that Nadab and Abihu brought, it was fire that they themselves had kindled. They had kindled it, and they were bringing it to the altar of the Lord. Why? To make their job probably a little bit easier. Maybe they were a little bit lazy. Maybe they were, you know, busy with other things, other sins, other nefarious activities, and they wanted to kind of skip some process in tending the flame of the Lord. We don't know. We can only surmise. But we do know that this fire on the altar, it was not the holy fire. It was a fire that was unknown to the altar. Friends, this place of mixture in our hearts, there is places of mixture where the pure fire that is lit in us, when God reaches in and delivers you from the power of sin and brings you into the kingdom of the Son of His love, He lights the fire on your heart. God, even today, He lights the flame of the Lord. I remember when my flame was lit. I grew up in the church. I had good parents, but I walked away from the Lord. I walked away. I saw some things that didn't quite make sense to me. I'll put it that way. And I walked away from the Lord for a time. But when I came back to the Lord, I had a radical encounter. I had fire burning all up and down my body. It wasn't something that somebody did to me. Nobody lit a match under me, okay? You know, nobody set a fire under my butt or something like that, right? But the fire of the Lord was literally burning. I actually said to the person who was ministering to me, "I'm burning, I'm burning, I'm burning." I had no idea what was happening to me. I'd never seen anything like that. I'd never experienced anything like that. I'd never felt anything like that. But it was real. It was more real than anything I had experienced, any sin that I had done, any pleasure of the flesh. It was more real to me than all of that because God Himself lit the flame in my heart. And friends, that is the flame that we are called to tend. That is the altar of our personal life that we are called to attend to. And the altar of a region or of a nation or of a marriage or of a family cannot be tended to by a person who does not attend to their personal altar. I have no authority out there that I don't have in here. I lose the warfare out there. When I lose the warfare in here, it starts in here. And that's what God is trying to say to us. See, so many people are offended right now. Matthew 24, friends, we are living in the midst of Matthew 24. We are living in the midst of Jesus' chief treatise on the end times, Matthew 24 and 25.